Always and forever, we begin with the praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send our prayers of peace upon the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We testify with firmness and conviction that there is none that is worthy of worship but He, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His worshipping slave and final messenger. Da'iman wa abadan, we always begin by reminding ourselves of taqwallah azza wa jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullaha haqqa tuqatih. O you who believe, be conscious and aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the capacity and to the ability that you are capable of and that He is deserving of you. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And do not depart this worldly life in a state other than willful, voluntary submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I understand, alhamdulillah, that this Al-Masjid Al-Mubarak, Masjid Umar, named after Umar al-Khattab al-Faruq radiallahu anhu arda, mashallah, it's a blessed place of learning. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the time that we spend together a time that is of rahmah and sakina, and that the angels descend upon us because we are seeking to mention the words of Allah وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ, to study the words of Allah Azza wa Jal. And my aim with you today, inshallah, tomorrow and Sunday, I'm going to be teaching a class, which is the tafsir of Surah Taha. And alhamdulillah, this class I've taught really almost around the world, from Australia to Europe to North America, and inshallah tomorrow in Vancouver. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts barakah in it for myself and those who attend. Allahumma ameen. We're going to begin with two ayah from Surah Taha. And inshallah, it kind of highlights our aim and mission in learning about the word of Allah. I want you to understand, ya ibadallah, that this Quran that was revealed upon the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a sacred trust. It's not just a book or a novel or a communication that when you need it, you turn to it. No, it is a direct revelation from Allah to humanity. And therefore the Sahaba and the Salaf, they would say that whenever you interact with the Quran, your assumption is it is as if it is revealed to you in your circumstance. It is applicable to your time, to your needs. And there are those of us who are moved by a single ayah. I've had friends of mine, Andrew, who stood in my room one day while I was at university. And he was visiting my home and I told him, look, I'll go get something, I'll come back. I went to get food or something. And I came back, there was a copy of the Quran, English and Arabic translation. I came back and this, you know, guy that I've known my whole life, he was crying, shedding tears. I said, what's wrong with you? You know, I was never really pushed him on Islam or anything. And he pointed to the Quran and he said, this is the truth. I said, why do you say that? He said, you know, when you went out, I wanted something, I just opened the Quran. And he said, when I opened it, I just opened it randomly. And the ayah that his eyes fell on were in Surah An-Nisa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَ ظُلْمًا. Those who consume the wealth of the orphans unjustly, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُولِهِمْ نَارًا. What they are doing is that they are consuming internally hellfire. They're preparing themselves for hellfire. And because I didn't know, his whole life, he was raised as an orphan from one foster care to another, and the people that were governed to look after him and were paid to look after him used the money not on him but on themselves, whether for drunkenness or holidays, and let him live a life of poverty and need. When that ayah came into his realm, into his life, it changed his universe. Ayah. And that's why we call it an ayah. It is a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he became from Andrew, he became Anwar. يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He leads whom he wants subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah, from the moment Adam alayhi salam was placed upon this earth, for thousands of years until Isa alayhi salam was lifted up from this earth, there was not a moment of time where there was no divine communication with humanity. There was always a prophet of Allah. There was always a messenger of Allah more than one walking the earth. And then revelation was suspended. Not for a day or a week. It was something unknown, uncommon. Neither the Jews nor the Christians or any of the sects that came before it even claimed that there was a prophet. They waited for the Messiah. They were waiting. When is he coming? So for about 600 years, the world was dark. And Allah sent the light. يُخْرِجُكُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Sent light, and it was as if that period of fatratin min al-rusul, that period of humanity not having a messenger to turn to, revelation to answer from, that moment of darkness, it was almost as if it was a purge of Allah cleansing all the fabrications and all the misunderstandings and all of that which had occurred. It was as if Allah had put a moment of cleansing and sent then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tamaman muhaiminan alayhi, as a completion of his favor. أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. I've sent to you the complete way of relationship between yourselves and myself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this Qur'an is something significant. It's the only document, not hadith, nothing else. It's the only document that when you look into it, it is ibadah. It is the only document that when you recite a letter of it with intention, it earns you thawab, reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment you utter alif, lam, meem, not even a word, single, cut letters, disjointed letters, you have earned 30 hasanat from Allah, wa yudha'ifu liman yasha, and Allah increases it for whom He wills. It's a special communication from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to humanity. And therefore anyone who turns into the Qur'an and looks into its words, finds in it what he seeks, and will find in it what he did not know he seeks. Shaykh al-Islam ibn al-Qayyim rahmatullahi alayhi, he would say, some will look into an ayah in the Qur'an and learn a lesson. And there were others who will look into the same ayah and learn 1,000 lessons. And there will those who will look into the ayah yesterday and learn one lesson, but look at it again today and learn 1,000 lessons. The same individual, the same person. And this is from the power and the majesty of the Qur'an. We're going to look at Surah Taha. Now, I want you to understand that this surah, it's a significant surah. This is the first time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a methodology of action in leading people. This is the first time that the Prophet ﷺ is going to hear of what other prophets before him endured. Previous to this is from the early Meccan revelations, Allah would mention the names, Suhufi Ibrahim wa Musa, in the books of Ibrahim and Musa. But the first time the Prophet ﷺ hears of Musa, of what his life was like, who he was sent to, what was the mission about, the struggles he endured to get here, how his mission began before revelation, and how it would end with revelation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we begin our discussion this evening with ayah number 9. وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. Ya Muhammad, has the narrative, has the story, the chronicle of Musa come to you? Now this is in the language of the Arab, it's a form of balagha where Allah isn't saying, have you heard it before? That's not what Allah's saying. Allah's saying, because you haven't heard it before, and because anything you might have heard related to Musa or related to his story is incomplete, pay attention to what I'm going to tell you about Musa alayhi salam. Notice how this ayah is a cliffhanger. Have you heard? Heard what? Most of the surahs that were revealed in Mecca had two unique symbols within them. One was the verses were short, and two, they had a cliffhanger. You wanted to hear what's next. Ar-Rahman, who is he? Allama al-Qur'an, what's this Qur'an? Who did he teach? خلق الإنسان, he created mankind. Then what? علمه البيان, short, concise, comprehensive, but leads you into wanting to know more. Because the people of Quraysh, they hated hearing the Quran in public, but loved listening to it in private without others knowing. An authentic hadith narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah describes the circumstance of Abu al-Hakam ibn Hisham. We call him Abu Jahl, the man of ignorance. And Abu Sufyan. At night, when the Prophet would be teaching the Quran in Dar al-Arqam, they would come quietly in the darkness, in the pitch black, and sit outside the window listening, يتأذنون القرآن, putting their ear to hear it. And one day they bumped into each other, and the one looked to the other and said, what are you doing here? What are you doing here? He said, I'm here because of what you're here. I'm just checking up on these people. He goes, wallahi, I know why you're here. Wallahi, innaka tajidu fihi halawa. Abu Jahl says to Abu Sufyan, I know why you're here, because you find beauty in it. وَمَا أَخْرَجْنِي مِنْ دَارِي إِلَّا مَا أَخْرَجَكْ. And I only left my home in the midst of the dark, in the middle of the night, of the thing that brought you, because I also enjoy listening to it. But they rejected it, not out of disbelieving in its truthful message. Because they believed, they are kuffar. Because they knew it's the truth, that's why they're kuffar. So they accepted the truth. Abu Jahl would later say, قال اللهم إن كان هذا هو الحق من عندك فأمطر علينا حجارة من السماء. He was so audacious in his disbelief, he said, Oh Allah, I know this truth is from you, but I would rather you send down hijara, stones from the heaven to kill me than to believe it. Allahu Akbar. This is kufr. This is his habit. Yet he loved to hear it. But didn't want anyone to know he enjoyed hearing it. Because it has this symmetry and beauty. It has elegance and something they can find, nothing comparable to it in the work of man. And the Prophet ﷺ, as Allah says in Surah Al-Kahf, which we recited earlier today, he says, لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسُكَ عَلَىٰ أَثَارِهِمْ. Ya Muhammad, you are so upset. In such severity is your sadness. When you see the traces, أثارهم, the traces of them sitting outside your home, listening to the Qur'an at night, إِن لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. But no, they will not believe in this message. صلى الله عليه وسلم. He was pained. هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. Have you heard the story of Musa? Notice, it's got that revelation of Mecca. Short verses. Who's Musa? The people of Quraysh haven't heard. Who's this Musa? What happened to him? What is the hadith of Musa? They used to hate hearing the Quran in public, that as soon as they would hear it, they would turn around and walk the other way. But because these verses were done short, they would hear one and then they would slow down a little. Well, I want to know what's next. عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ. What are they questioning? I don't know. Let me walk back. عن النبأ العظيم, about the great happening. What is it? الذي هم فيه مختلفون. They remain divided about it. Right? They want to hear more. So they would slow their pace or turn around. Some of them would say to the Hujjaj who were coming into Mecca, put cotton in your ear. فَإِنَّ كَلَامَهُ كَالسِّحْرِ. Because the words of Muhammad ﷺ, they're like magic. يُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ الْأَبِي وَابْنِهِ. He splits the father and son. وَالرَّجُلِ وَامْرَأَتَهُ. A man and his wife may separate on account of one of them believing in him and the other not believing. صلى الله عليه وسلم. هَلْ أَتَاكَ. Pay attention to what is being revealed to you about Musa. إِذْ رَأَى نَارًا فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِهِمْ كُثُوا إِنِّي آنَسْتُ نَارًا لَعَلِّي آتِيكُم مِّنْهَا بِقَبَسٍ أَوْ أَجِدُ عَلَى النَّارِ هُدًى. This is the only ayah that we're going to study tonight, inshallah. Moses, alayhi salam, escaped Egypt after killing a man unintentionally. He ran away. He was being extorted. The person who saw him, who he helped in defending him, when he noticed that Musa was full of strength and saw how the force of his blow caused that man to fall over and die, he said to him, From now on, if you don't do what I ask you and harm who I want you to harm, سأستصرخك. I'm going to tell people that you're a murderer. Musa, when he heard this, he was scared. I don't want to kill anyone else. And I don't want to be held accountable as a murderer when it was unintentional. I was trying to save this man's life. He listened to an advisor and ran away, went to Madian, which is northern Arabia. Something that a lot of people don't know is that Musa's wife is Arabi. She was an Arab from the descendants of Ismail alayhi salam. And this is, you know, one of the paradoxes of life, that you find so much tension in parts of the world where there really is cousin relationships in faith. And Musa alayhi salam grew up amongst these people of Madian to become a full man in those 10 years of serving in the house and being married and raising a flock. He came to a decision, he wants his own land and wants to move somewhere else. And as they are traveling in the desert at night, he is a seasoned shepherd, a seasoned person who can live outdoors, a nomad. He finds himself in a bitterly cold night, and his fuel supply is lost, his water supply has dwindled, and his animals have scattered. And in the middle of that circumstance, he gets lost. ضَلَّ الطَّرِيق. Doesn't know where he's going. So he sees what he thinks is a fire. And up on the mountain, he sees this light that he assumes as a shepherd can only be one thing. There are other shepherds or other men sheltering in a cave or somewhere up there. Let me go find assistance. One of the things that's important is that those who are traveling with him do not see the light. They don't see it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins this ayah by saying, إِذْ رَأَى نَارًا. Moses saw the fire, not his family. فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِ. He said to his family, أُمْكُثُ. Stay here. Usually if you look in an English translation, it says, stay here. I'm going to go over there. I'm going to bring you back some fire, some heat, maybe some food. وَأَجِدُ عَلَى النَّارِ هُدًى. And maybe those people who are camped there, I can ask them for directions. From this ayah, we're going to take 10 important lessons, inshallah, about family organization and management, about standing up for our responsibilities as men. In this ayah, Allah shows 10 qualities that Musa possesses as a man that all of us can implement and learn and use in our life, in our business life, in our school life, in our home and domestic life with our spouse. First lesson, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ رَأَى نَارًا فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِهِ. He saw this fire, so he immediately said to his family. One is to believe in yourself. You know, sometimes you understand something and three or four people around you haven't seen the same thing, haven't understood the same thing, and it's easy for you to change what you are definitely sure is truth based on the influence of others. And this is a point of weakness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here shows that Musa, it's not out of arrogance that he presses what he saw in comparison to what they saw. But Musa alayhi salam begins a discussion with them, showing them what are the benefits of them listening to his claim to believe in yourself. Number two, Musa alayhi salam, when he sees this fire, he makes a split decision. Immediately comes to a decision, he's gonna go alone. Now for us married brothers, alhamdulillah, us happily married brothers, you can almost see yourself, you know, you're driving from Calgary through the mountains to Vancouver. And due to your navigation, your mistake, you're the leader, your car breaks down or you run out of petrol. It's dark, it's cold. And you say to your wife, stay here, I'll be back. I could almost see your wife and my wife saying, I'm not going. Where you're going, I'm going. You're not leaving me nowhere. There's bears out here. I'm coming with you. There's wolves out here, Ya Musa. There's snakes and scorpions. There's bandits. Where you go, I go. But here, you see in this narrative, Musa, alayhi salam, he says something, and they listen. Now this is strange for us men to grasp. You know, you say something, and all of a sudden, the wife says, okay, honey, go on. What? Musa's got something that we're missing. Let's discover what it is, inshallah. Musa, alayhi salam, number three, is heard, and I don't want to use the word obeyed, but his perspective is agreed to because he does three essential things. Three things that many of us as men do not do. First is discuss. He says to his family, Allah says, قَالَ لِأَهْلِ. He spoke to all of his family. Not just one side of his family, not just his wife in lieu of his kids. Most of the mufassirin, they tell you that he had a group of people, elders, youngsters, cousins, you know, he had his wife's family with her. He spoke to all of them. And you can almost see from the narrative that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's almost as if he's trying to convince them. فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِ إِنِّي آنَسْتُ نَارًا. I have a feeling. The word آنَسْتُ, it's not رَأَيْتُ. I see it. Because if you see it, I should see it. He says آنَسْتُ. الْأُنْس means I feel it. I saw it, but you can't see, but I know it's there. You know when you have that feeling? I know it's there. Alright, but I'm not just going to let you go because you feel it, Ya Musa. Tell me more. Why would I let you go and leave us in this place? He says, لَعَلِّي آتِيكُمْ. Perhaps I can bring you this. So he's negotiating the terms of his departure. Second thing he does, Musa alayhi salam does not promise a result. You know how some brothers, sometimes we make the mistake, we say, I'm going to go get it. You're not sure you can get it. You think, yani, look at Musa, he says, لَعَلِّي, perhaps, maybe, by chance, I might walk all the way up there and look over into the mountainside and see that these guys are rough looking, and I might get scared and I might back up. I might not get anything. I might not get any fire, get nothing. I might go all the way there and leave you and come back empty handed. I might go all the way there, speak to them and ask them and they give me nothing. لَعَلِّي. And that's an important measure of a man. Do not ever promise what you are not sure you can deliver. Number three, so he's discussed. He hasn't promised. He's upfront. You could see that Musa alayhi salam is diligent, forthright with honesty. He doesn't promise the world. Number three, he's prioritized their needs. He's put them before himself. How do we know this? Allah uses a very important word, and it's important for us to understand the nuances of translation. When we translate the Qur'an, it's not Qur'an. Whatever you read other than this, is not the Qur'an. It's what a guy thinks or a lady thinks they understood from the Qur'an. That's it. At a given period of time. And therefore when you put the explanations, even subhanAllah in Surah Al-Fatiha, you know, if you were to look at the 25 or 30 translations in English, three of them agree on one statement and others say something else. And the three are actually most correct. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Most will translate it, lead us to the straight path, guide us to the straight path. Not the path of those whom you allowed to be misguided. This is most of the people of translation will write it this way. It's actually most correct to say, it's not Allah saying not the path of those. Lead us to the path of those whom you have guided. upon the path who have not angered you. It's not what they've done, but it's the path they've walked, they've taken. And therefore there's a subtle change in the language that changes the meaning completely. You find this in this ayah and many ayat in the Quran. Allah here subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِهِ أُنْكُثُوا. The word umkuthu in Arabic, in all of the translations, it's translated as stay here. You know, it's like he's a big man. He said, hey, sit over here, I'll be back. That's almost how it makes it sound. But that's not what Musa said. Umkuthu is a word in Arabic that implies comfort and protection. So Allah tells you in the Quran, Quranan, this Quran, we brought it down upon you, Ya Muhammad, لِتَقْرَأَهُ عَلَى مُكْثٍ. That you recite it, Allah uses the same word, to find comfort. Allah describes us in Jannah, inshaAllah ta'ala, by saying, مَاكِثِينَ فِيهِ أَبَدًا. When you get to Jannah, you're gonna be chilled out forever, comfortable forever, happy forever. That is the word that Musa uses. Umkuthu. Meaning, I've made the place ready for you. I'm not leaving you in the cold. I'm not leaving you in a place that's not secure. I've cleaned this cave up. I've given you as much water I have. I've put you in a place that even if I don't return, you will survive. Umkuthu. Relax here until I return. That's a huge difference from someone saying to his wife on the road to Vancouver from Calgary, wait here in the car. And he's left her without anything. No phone reception, nothing. That's a complete difference to the attitude of Musa alayhi salam. Another quality that we extract from this ayah is that even in a moment of weakness and in a moment of need, even when he's lost and his wife is upset and the children are crying and they're in a bitter cold, Musa still thinks about all of the advantages he can have. So when he thinks about what he's going to say to these people, he says, I'm going to ask them for fire. I'm going to take from them qabasin. I'm going to take from them some coal. And even if I don't get this, at least I'm going to ask them for directions. And this fiqh of prioritization is an essential ingredient for every successful household and for every leader of a household. That even in your moments of disadvantage, you're looking for advantage. You're looking for ways to become successful. For the means in your moment of brokenness, how to become whole again, to the greatest capacity and in the shortest period of time. Another quality that Musa displays, alayhi salam. He is not greedy. Musa alayhi salam doesn't expect that those he is going to see are going to host him. You know how some people, they're kind of silly. They've done, you know, in their life there's something broken or something not well, they're lost or this or that. And they think, just because I'm in need, I can throw myself at others. Musa doesn't say to his wife, come on honey, there's fire up there. Let's go. We'll all get warm. We'll all have shelter. No. He's realistic. He's pragmatic. He doesn't put his responsibility on other people. Takes care of his responsibility. He says, let me go alone. Another reason for this is he's intelligent and puts his family's safety before his and others. Could you imagine if you're out in the Sinai desert back 5,000 years ago at the time of Musa? Do you think you would want to take your wife and little children up into a valley where you don't know who the people are? You don't know what you expect from their reception? You're going to just skip along in the mountainside? Let's go honey, they're probably nice people. Ya Wallah, he's a smart man. He takes with him his stick, he says you wait here, don't make a sound, because even if I get hurt, at least you're safe. He's ensured their safety. He's not sure of that danger, so he doesn't put them in danger. And this is number 8 as a fiqh that we learn from Musa, that the danger to one person is better than the danger to many. I'm going to face this danger, but I don't want all of you to face it. I would rather go up, and this is, you know, from his rujula, from his manliness, that he puts himself in harm's way on account of his family and his children, hoping for their safety. But he doesn't do it recklessly. He doesn't say, we'll all go together. He's smart enough to protect them from an unknown danger. Number nine, he teaches us that a danger that is known to us is easier to manage than a danger that is unknown to us. Musa knows the danger of being lost in the desert, not having fire, not having food. At least he knows what he's dealing with. But going out there and trying to find these people and find this fire, he doesn't know what waits for him. And therefore he is careful. You have to be more careful with the unknown danger than the danger that you can calculate for and look after. And finally, from the lessons that we learn from Musa alayhi salam in this instance, is that the instructions that he provides his family are never only for his interest. Everything he says to them is seeking their interest in mind. And the only way that we will find, you know, my wife and your wife who will follow you in difficulty is that she knows, and your children know, and your father and your mother know, that even though you are walking into a path of difficulty, you are doing it with the best interest that they have in mind. It's not self-serving. It's not trying to prove yourself to others. It's only for their benefit. And when those conditions come together, you've made them comfortable, you've tried to protect them from danger, you put yourself in harm's way for them, you don't have an interest more than their interest, you have taken the precautions that you can, and you have rationalized and discussed it with the big and the older, the mature, the elder, and the youngsters, and you have explained it from different vantage points, the only outcome will be, yes, I agree, you can go, my husband. And therefore you garner that respect as a Muslim man seeks to have within his home and within his people. The next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا أَتَاهَا نُودِيَ يَا مُوسَى. Allah begins the ayah with the letter fa. And this fa, it's not lamma ataha. It's not when he came. It's as soon as he left them, he came. Meaning that the moment he made sure they were safe, he ran. He spent as much energy as he could to go find this fire, to come see it. But when he came to it, he saw it wasn't fire. Ataha, not falamma atannar. So Allah begins with the letter fa, and this fa, to the language of the Quran, it's called fa al-ta'qib, a fa that denotes immediacy, that the thing happened soon after, that it was diligent and expressive, and it's almost like an emergency circumstance. He left his family in a rush, wanting to get what he thought he was going to receive from this fire. فَلَمَّا أَتَاهَا. But when he came to it, he saw it wasn't a fire. It was light that bewildered him, and he was fearful, and he began to run away. Nudiya, Allah called out to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Musa, Moses, come back. And the journey with Surah Taha is a journey that mimics the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as such, when Jibreel descended upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Iqra, read. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know what to read, who it was that was speaking to him, what it was he was to receive and to be revealed to him. Ma ana biqara, what am I to read? What am I to do with this? The Prophets of Allah never expected that they were better than others. They never thought that they were more worthy than others. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who walked the streets of Mecca as Musa walked the Sha'ab of Madian and the places of Sinai, never anticipated that they were valuable enough that Allah would use them as a tool for the humanity, for humanity's purpose. And therefore I turn to you and I in self-reflection. Sometimes we equally underestimate the powers that Allah has given us. And sometimes you look to yourself and you say, what can I do in the world? What can I do? And I'm here to tell you, you know, before I conclude, that you cannot change the world. It's difficult to admit to yourself, you cannot. I'm telling you, wallahi, you cannot change the world. Even if people tell you, yes, you can make a difference and change the world. You cannot. But you can change someone's world. I want you to understand the difference. You cannot change the world. But you can change the world for one or two or three or four or 100 people. You do have that. Living here in this city with the resources you have, with the technology you possess, with the social networks you encounter, with the people that you meet, with the, you know, the telecommunications that is at access to us, with the money that you earn. You can change someone's world. And therefore the Prophet ﷺ, he tells us that the path to success in the Akhirah lies in our service to others in the dunya. You always hear the Prophet ﷺ say these things. He says, "Irhamu man fil ard, yarhamkum man fis sama." Show mercy and compassion to those on earth, the one above the heavens will be compassionate to you. He says, "Khayrukum, the best of you, man ta'allama al-Qur'ana wa 'allama." The one who learns from the Qur'an and teaches it. Oh, brother, I don't know the whole Qur'an. No, ya akhi, you know more of the Qur'an than you want to admit to yourself. You know enough that you can teach a couple of children something from the Qur'an. You know enough that you can teach a new brother about the Qur'an. Or an older Muslim who's shy to attend classes the Qur'an. How many Muslims have peaked in their relationship with the Qur'an in their 20s? Yeah, brother, I've had, you know, people say, brother Yahya, you know, I'm shy now, I'm 30. I'm going to go and learn, you know, tajweed now. People are going to look at me, you know, kind of strange. That mentality holds you back. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, صَدَقَةَ السِّرُّ تُطْفِئُ غَضَبَ الرَّبِّ. Charity that you give without others knowing, no one knows what you gave or to who or to how much or when or where, extinguishes, eliminates Allah's wrath, anger against us. Allahu Akbar. It's always about interaction. When you listen to what Allah says about our Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah uses the Prophet as an extension of His rahmah to all that exists. What's the Prophet's job, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. What is your job, Ya Muhammad? To be a source of mercy and compassion to all that exists. The tree cried, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he hugged it until it stopped. The camel wept, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he whispered to it and unburdened it. The Muslims were comforted by him, and the unbelievers were given time and comfort by him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rahmah, a spring of mercy to others. And therefore, when you look at the Quran and you hear the life of Musa and you see the life of Muhammad, you see that the purpose of their existence was the service of others, helping others, fulfilling what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills amongst humanity in others. Can you imagine that Allah describes an act of iman? That Allah says, from iman, the Prophet ﷺ teaches us, imatatu al-adha min al-tariq, is to move something harmful from the path of those who might come. You don't know who's coming. It could be a man or woman or anything. It could be a Muslim or another. It could be an animal. I was just reading before I arrived while in the hotel, something one of my teachers wrote. And he said, a sadaqah that Allah speaks about in the Quran and that the Prophet ﷺ shared was not just limited to those who we love. Sometimes we give sadaqah to those, you hear about Syria, sadaqah. You hear about sadaqah. My family in back home in Egypt, sadaqah. It's almost as if it's attached to those who need. But the greatest elements of sadaqah that the Prophet ﷺ describes, some of them were to people who you would not consider. And I conclude with these two hadith. The first hadith is in Bukhari, narrated from Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu arda. The Prophet ﷺ says, كَانَ فِي مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ. In the nation that preceded your nation, there was a man, a well-known man, an imam, a rabbi, who everyone knew what he looked like, how he dressed, how he sounded. And this man, when he went to sleep at night, there was a particular night, he felt uneasy. He had a need that he could not solve. And that's you and I. Every one of us, you might have wealth but not health. You might have wealth and health, but the one you love is missing one of them. So you're up at night. All of us have something that plays in our mind before we sleep. And this man was in that moment. He had something that he, although he possessed many skills, he could not fix for himself his problem. فَقَالَ لِنَفْسِهِ. So the Prophet said, this man said to himself, سَأَتَصَدَّقُ اللَّيْلَةَ. I will go out tonight and give charity. فَأَوَّلَ مَنْ أَلْتَمِسُ. The first person I touch, meaning I'm going to go out in the darkness of the night. I don't want to say a word. I don't want them to know who I am. I'm going to change my clothing and go to a different part of the city where people don't know who I am. And the first person I meet and come in contact with, I'm going to give them charity. Because if I solve someone's problem, Allah will solve my problem. So the first person he touched, came in contact with that night, he gave him charity and ran. فأصبحت المدينة, the city he lived in the next morning, يضحكون أهل المدينة. People in the city are laughing. He says to, as he comes out of that, what happened? Why is everyone amused? They said, تصدق البارحة على سارق. Someone last night, in the darkness of the night, gave charity to a thief. Meaning there was a guy sitting in the dark waiting to rob him. And you know, waiting with the knife out, I'm gonna take his money. And just before he's gonna say, give me your money or I take your life, just before he robs him, he says, here's some charity, and ran away. He went back and told the others, can you imagine what happened to me? This has never happened before. I was about to rob this guy and he gave me charity. The man heard this. He's a rabbi, imam. فَقَالَ لَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ صَدَقَ التَّصَدُّقَ عَلَى سَارِقَ. Allah's not going to accept charity. I wanted a, you know, an orphan, someone like this. I didn't want a thief. I'm going to go out tomorrow. So that night he went out again, the next night, and gave the next first person he touched. And the next morning he woke up, everyone's laughing more. What happened? تُصُدِّقَ اللَّيْلَ الْبَارِحَ. Last night someone gave charity عَلَى عاهرة عزكم الله, upon a lady who sells herself. May Allah protect our families. He said, Allah's not going to accept charity to. No. I'm going to go a third night. Next night he goes. Now, but see, this shows you the determination of the believer. He didn't just say, I gave it, Allah knows my intention. No. He's intent on pleasing Allah. He goes out the third night. Gives charity, everyone now is on the floor laughing. What happened? What did he give charity this time? قَالُوا تُصُدِّقَ عَلَى غَنِيِّنَا. Someone gave charity to the richest man in the city. Who gives charity to the emperor? فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ. The Sahaba laughed, as you and I laugh. The Prophet ﷺ said, أما الأولى, as that first night, أخذ السارق الصدقة واكتفى ولم يأذي أحد. The thief took that charity and said, it's enough for me, and did not hurt anyone else. Allahu Akbar. وأما الثانية, the second night, فأخذت الصدقة وعفت نفسها. The woman who took this charity, she said, I don't have to dishonor myself tonight. And she stayed home and protected her family and her children. And as the third night, the king, he received the sadaqah. وَقَالَ لِنَفْسِهِ سَأَخْرُجُ الرَّابِعَةِ I'm going to go out tomorrow to give charity to others. He saw that although he has this wealth, he's not doing what those beneath him are doing. So he said, I'm going to do this tomorrow night. I'm not going to let anyone know. I'm going to go out and give charity. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَحْقِرَنَّ مِنَ الْمَعْرُوفِ شَيْئًا Never look down at a good thing you do. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I was driving to give the Jumu'ah at UBC, you know, we went through this part of town where there's a lot of, you know, people without homes and, you know, it looks rough. And I remembered this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes, you know, you pull your children and say, hey, don't give them, move, they're going to drink it, they're going to do this, they're going to do that. Yes, perhaps they're going to take the $2, the $5 you take, and not harm anyone else that might come after you. And you might be looking at it from your perspective, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might be sending you as their rizq. Allahu Akbar. Or as rizq for someone else in protection for them. Don't look down at any good thing you do. Always seek to make the good you do for Allah. This is why the man, he was so sincere. Night after night, he wants to prove himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Last hadith that I leave you with is the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Sahih Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there was a lady, may Allah protect our families, who used to sell herself. She saw a dog that was tied up, unable to get food or water. So she untied the dog, and gave it some water and food. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَٰلِكَ For no other reason other than that act. This is a person that you and I, if we drive down that part of town, you see that kind of person standing, you say, disease, home wrecker, this. The Prophet ﷺ said, she did an act of kindness to an animal. مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَٰلِكَ Because of that deed, غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَهَا مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهَا Allah forgave all her sins, وَأَدْخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ and admitted her to Jannah. Why does the Prophet ﷺ say these words? Because you and I, we look at the outer actions and the moments of a person's life, but we don't know what brought them to that condition. You may not see that at 5 years old there was molestation. At 10 years old, there was running away from home and a disruptive home and assault that were occurring to them. You may not know of miscare in foster homes. You may not know that at 14 they were hooked onto drugs. You may not know that if she was given your life, she would be a better Muslim than you. If she was given what you were given, and you saw how she used your life, you would be ashamed of yourself. مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَلِكَ Because of that act, because for her to be nice to that little animal, it's greater than what you would give even if you gave the charity of Uhud. This is the reality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our circumstances and knows why we do what we do. Don't ever, Abdullah, وَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ Hold yourself higher in estimation of taqwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows the ease that you have been provided and the good that you have been provided. So I repeat my invitation to you and myself. take advantage of the luxuries that you have been given, the security that you have in this great country, the ability to have free education, healthcare, the opportunities that are provided for you to speak to people about faith, uninhibited freedom of faith and practice and religion. Take this, that even in our own homelands, where we might come from, that these same liberties are not even accessible. You would not be able to sit as we sit like this in Syria. You would not be able to sit like this even in Egypt. Right? فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be conscious of what Allah has provided you and use it for your benefit and the benefit of others. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَصَلِّ اللَّهُمَّ وَسَلِّمْ وَزِدْ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا وَنَبِيِّنَا وَحَبِيبِنَا مُحَمَّدْ صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. It is a pleasure and an honor to have met and sat with you for a few moments and shared some words from the Quran and from our Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.